There we go. Hello, Boston. Her story, be bold. Yeah, those dance moves, they're not so good. They're a little rusty these days. I'm kicking them from the 80s. But Kathy Kiley, where are you? Thank you so much for having me to the Ad Club. I'm so delighted to be among all of you powerful, kick-ass women. So much of our work since we at 50 Eggs opened our doors has been focused on women, on issues that need uncovering, and ultimately motivating people to action. But the start of 50 Eggs was actually due to a number of mistakes, and to some key women, and to a key brand. My very first film was a documentary called A Hero for Daisy, and around the same time I began to work on that, I had been writing these screenplays that were kicking around Hollywood. And they were about, like, I remember looking around, and all of the images that I would see on the screen were, you know, like these beautiful, long-legged, blonde women, sort of two-dimensional. And I remember thinking, you know, where are the women with the big legs be at? Where are they? Where are the ones that are irritatingly smart? And so I started writing these screenplays that were literally bouncing around Hollywood. And I remember sending one a script to Sherry Lansing, who was running Paramount at the time. And I sent her an Olympic t-shirt. And I said something like, let's do this. I'm sure she opened it up for her assistant. Was like, what the? I get a call. It's like, you know, when are you next in Hollywood? Oh, I'm there all the time, right? When are you next in LA? Like, our head of development wants to meet with you, and Sherry would like to meet with you. Well, little did I know that Hollywood, and some of you know, like, everybody's, like, got these big smiles. They're like, you're so talented. You're such a great writer. And I'm like, inside, I'm like, yay. And, you know, I walk out the door, and you know the first thing they're doing, they're taking my script and, you know, deep-sixing it. But I didn't know that at the time. And so none of my screenplays sold, but I was getting these really intriguing meetings. And so I started making a documentary. And I never intended to make a documentary, but I was sort of I was a young lawyer at the time, and I was kind of a flunky student at BU Film School. And we had to make a thesis film. And my husband said something that was so important. And he said, you know, if you're gonna do something, like, do a real thing. So what? I love him. He's keeping it real. And what really catalyzed my first film? I was 9 months pregnant, and I got swollen feet. I'm so fat, and I'm sinking into the couch. And I'm a young lawyer. And oh, by the way, I wish somebody had told me when you're pregnant. Like, I remember doing this deal. I was a real estate lawyer, and it's a marathon deal. And I get up, because it's 7 o'clock and nobody's brought in dinner. And so I remember getting up and I said, well, I'm not happy. And the other side said, excuse me, let's convene. And they came in with an offer that was like $10 million higher. Who knew? I wish I had known. Anyways, I often digress and go off the reservation. But so I'm 9 months pregnant, I'm swollen, I'm just really miserable. And a Victoria's Secret campaign came on. Okay, I'm like fully loaded. You know, I got my lazy boy. I've got the ho-hos, the ring-dings. It's the perfect array. And so this ad comes on, and you know, these women, they're beautiful, and the lips, and I remember there was like the shower, right? Like, and they're like, oh, you know, and the this, and the that. And I'm like, oh, I'm looking down at my belly, and I was about to have a daughter. And I start muttering, you know, ho-hos are like around my chin. You know, my husband comes in, he's like, whoa. Shit. What's wrong with her? And he's like, I said, oh, you know, I'm like pointing. And he's like, yeah, that's nice. And so he's like, I know it's going to fix this. He runs out. He gets fish food ice cream. He thinks that's the end of it. And that, my friends, was just the beginning. I had this epiphany that night. And I said, this is the world that my daughter is coming into, right? Where women are objectified and they're tied up with a nice, neat little bow with no voice and really skinny legs, and they're all blonde. And listen, let me show you, okay? My daughter was not going to have skinny legs. I'll pull it higher if you want. nor was she going to be blonde. So I set out to make A Hero for Daisy, and I made it because I had to make it. And A Hero for Daisy was my first documentary, and it was about these great women at Yale in the 70s. And I was about 10 at the time this happened, so I had never heard of this story. And there were these rowers, so I was a rower, they would go 20 minutes on a bus, they would row in the wind, in the rain, in the snow. They would have to get on an unheated bus while every last man would shower and come out, the steam coming off, eating steak, and they'd have to wait till every last man got on the bus. And then because it was the men's locker room, the women couldn't use it. And two of these women were going on to represent the United States in the Olympic Games. The women that year at Yale, they were winning all of their races. The men were winning zero. And I heard about this story where the rowing team got together and they tried diplomatic channels and they were told, oh, the wheels here at Yale grind slowly. The progress will be very slow, but we're on it, girls. And they waited a year and nothing changed. And finally they said, all right, we have to do something dramatic. We pay tuition like the boys. We need to make a point. So they stormed the athletic director's office, stripped, had Title IX in blue marker on breasts and backs. And that story, like, went around the world. You know, the Herald Tribune and the New York Times, you know, these crazy women at Yale stripping, like, what's going on there? And all these alums started sending in checks, like, please put clothes on these women. And it was a great moment in history about Title IX, about gender equity, and I had never heard of it. And so I set out to make this little movie, right? So I have these dreams of like a chair in Hollywood, you know, Mazzio, I don't smoke, but you know, Mazzio, and I'd have like this look. And little did I know this would be the start of something frankly more important. And so I started making this movie. And I didn't know what the hell I was doing, right? Like, not a clue. And I had three guardian angels along the way. One was my mother. And she gave me sort of the most important lesson of my life. Never take no for an answer. And I was being told no left and right. Never take no. And she said to me, no means no for that second, that minute only. I was like, what a great viewpoint. Like, okay, so I can make it into yes, right? She's like, well, it's not that easy. The second person, my second guardian angel, was from a big ad agency in Boston, Arnold Advertising. Margie Sullivan, are you here? Margie Sullivan, where are you? Where are you? Okay, stand up. Margie Sullivan. is responsible in so many ways for my film career. Somebody said, oh, I know this woman at Arnold. And if she thinks you're full of shit, she's going to kick you out of her office in 2 minutes. So I walk into Arnold. I'm a young lawyer, so I'm in a suit. And I'm passing all these people with, you know, ripped jeans, and I'm like, oh. And so I walk into Margie's office. Margie, I don't know if you remember this. She literally did this. Like, gave me the once-over, like, who the hell are you? And she's like, what do you need? And so I just blurt out. And Margie looked me up and down. I'm like, okay, she sees I'm full of shit. I'm gone. And she said, let me put you on speakerphone. Margie pulled in, because she had been running production at Arnold, I think every favor in the city, sound mix, editorial, music. And Margie is one of the key reasons that this film ever got made. Really, truly. And the third guardian angel was a brand, two brands actually, and somewhat male brands. And they were Welch's and New Balance. They both jumped in when we had no distribution, no track record. I didn't know what the hell I was doing. And they jumped in because they believed in the message of the film. Jim Davis, the CEO of New Balance, had a daughter who, like so many other daughters, was about to encounter the working world and the world of glass ceilings. Ditto for the CEO of Welch's, Dan Dillon, at the time. That film, oh, and I'll never forget, one of my, I had real investors, so I was like, oh, I better look legit. So I draw up, you know, I was a lawyer, so this is cool. I draw up shares, right? People got shares. And I tell you, one investor said, Mary, I need you to calculate the internal rate of return. I called up one of my business school friends. I'm like, how do I calculate an internal rate of return? So my business, they're like, are you joking? Like, what planet are you on? So I go back to the investor and I said, okay, I have to tell you, all of your capital is at risk. That's your effing internal rate of return. And I said, but assuming we do X in t-shirt sales, we do Y in ticket sales, we do Z in corporate sponsorship, you'll have an internal rate of return of 7.92%. He pulls out his, he's grinning, right? He pulls out his checkbook, he's like, okay, I fully expect you to keep me informed. Here's the crazy, I walked out, I'm sweating. I got stains bigger than, you know, and I'm like, I just sold this guy a steaming pile of air. And I'm like palpitating because I'm like, I'm a fraud. I'm like, I just talked him into a check and yay. For a year, I literally, and I had six investors, I had a stomachache for a year. How am I going to pay them back? How am I going to pay them back? What was crazy about that exercise, and another important lesson my mother taught me, which was like Grace said, you know, go for it, but believe in yourself. We achieved by a factor of 10x corporate sponsorship, ticket sales, revenue, and I then understood, oh, I kind of acted like a man, right, going into that meeting, right? So to the brothers in the room, we love you. But we know how confident you can be, and that taught me so much about why did I have these low expectations of myself. So what I didn't realize with that film, with her story, right, because this was all about women empowering not just each other, but a nation in so many ways, that I had no idea that we were getting into the social impact business. And that film, 17 years later, I made that in 2000. That film, I'm dining out on it still today. There are symposiums that have it. It has been viewed by millions of kids. I did a film about famous athletes, and I'm filming Drew Bledsoe. And his brother walks in and says, I mentioned, oh, yeah, I made these movies. He's like, I saw that in my class at, like, University of Bumpkinville, right? And I was like, oh, yay, University of Bumpkinville, love that. And the impact of that film from a brand standpoint was so interesting for both Welch's and New Balance because they actually said, they actually did some marketing analysis and they said, you know, how did you feel about the company before you saw A Hero for Daisy? Male, doesn't care about our issues, you know, conservative. How did you feel about our brand after seeing a hero for Daisy? Progressive, good corporate citizen. Here's the kicker. How more likely are you to buy New Balance sneakers after seeing this movie? 68% said they were more likely to buy sneakers. So this for me was, you know, sort of this methodology became so important. And 17 years later, This film is used by sports teams, women's history, curriculum in high schools, and in an era when New Balance competitors, Nike, Under Armour, Adidas, they're outfitting college teams. What do kids put on to watch to get fired up before a race? And what are the first logos they see? Yeah, baby. I'm coming for you. We even had a team, two teams actually, call up and say, can we use the tagline from this movie? It was called Dream a Little, Sweat a Lot. And we had kids with T-shirts and emblazoning gold rings for each other. So that experience made me understand that we are not just film producers, but that we're in the inspiration business, the motivate people to action business, the get shit done business. That's what we're in. And each of our films, since we opened our doors in 2000, has attracted more attention, and each has had increasing impact in a really profound and wide variety of ways. I'm going to fast forward to, before I tell you about our new film, a film we did a couple of years ago called Underwater Dreams. That film was about four undocumented boys, Phoenix, Arizona, ground zero for immigration. They were brought to this country when they were babies, you know, backs of cars over the border. And these boys built an underwater robot out of sticks and clay and duct tape. And they entered it in a really sophisticated underwater robotics competition. And they hauled ass across the country to compete. And they entered the collegiate division, ended up defeating every college team, including MIT. What an extraordinary accomplishment and reminder to all of us that talent may be in very unusual places, but not unusual to these kids. That film, with key brands, 3M, Motorola Solutions, went on to, in partnership with the White House, raise more than $100 million in private and public partnership money to fund programs for inner-city, low-income, disenfranchised neighborhoods, kids that wanted to study science, math, and technology. And I was telling Sarah in the green room that we had an opportunity with the White House. I started getting these, like, invitations to show up. And I'm like, okay, this is cool. Like, I'm not sure why we're being invited, but I'm going to, like, go with the flow. I'm going to wear a white jacket, you know, for the White House. Nobody noticed. So my husband said, my husband, yet again, he's like a godsend for any entrepreneur that leans on somebody, right? So my husband said, you know, you got to have a line if you're going to meet the president. And I said, I'm not going to meet the president. This is like a big event. There's just no chance. He said, you got to have a line. And he's like, what about, and he starts thinking of lines for me, right? Her story. Okay, I'm the only one that laughed at that. So he said, what about the time when our son was at camp and Malia was across the camp, the girls' camp, my son was at the boys' camp, and she literally lost control of her sailboat, crashes right into my son's sailboat, capsizes. My son's about to go overboard, and out of nowhere, you know, son, do not enter the water. Do not enter the water. You know, Secret Service. And I'm like, oh, that's a long line. If I get a chance to meet the president, that's a mouthful. And it's creepy. I know where your kid is. No, that's not going to fly. So instead, I'm like, I'm not going to meet the president. And then I get this text on my cell phone. It's like, you know, very cloak and dagger. It's like unknown. Meet under the JFK portrait at 10 a.m. I'm like, okay, somebody's noticed my white jacket. This is awesome. So I'm standing under the JFK portrait, and there's like nine other gentlemen, like really nice suited, and I should have taken the opportunity because, as I later discovered, they were all billionaires. Note to self. And they usher us in a room, and I'm like, okay, this is getting more and more intriguing, and in fact, there's 10 of us, and we're going to meet the president. So I start getting little rings. I'm like, oh, shit, what's my line? My son capsized. Fuck, no. So he walks in, and you know, he's like bigger than life. For those of you that have met him, I mean, it's just like the teeth, right? So I'm staring at the teeth. I'm like mesmerized by the teeth. And I shake his hand. And so it's like so-and-so, you know, CEO of Cisco, and so-and-so CEO, and I'm like, oh. And I'm like, Mr. President, my name's Mary Mazzio. He's like, nice to meet you, but you know, enough with the white jacket, he's moving on. And I'm holding on, so I was in the Olympic Games, right? So I'm holding on to his hand. I'm not letting that thing go. And I look down, and I'm like, oh, shit, what's my line? What's my fucking line? And I look up at him, and he's kind of, you know, he's like, all right, I need to move on. And I said, you know, Mr. President, I was here 20 years ago at the White House with the Olympic team, but it's so much more meaningful for me to be here today with you, with this project, and with these four young men who are the epitome of what it means to be American. And I'm still holding his hand. And he pulls back, and he's like, that's awesome. That's cool. You're an Olympian. And, you know, you lose yourself. You're like, here's my new friend. And I literally did this, and I'm embarrassed still. And I like take his hand up, and I'm like, seriously, I went to the leader of the free world. I'm like, yeah, check out the gun show. I'm now over the age of 40, for Christ's sakes. Check out there's no gun show. But I'm like this, and I'm still gonna see his hand, right? And he's like, he was so quick. He's like, yeah, what do you see, Michelle's, right? That, my friends, was a moment. So I'm going to take you to my newest film. I think we're going to roll the trailer, and then I'll come back and tell you about it. So can we roll the trailer? This is, our newest film is called I Am Jane Doe. I'm on tour with it now. And let's roll the trailer.
This is the United States. There's no possible way this is true.
I sent her out with one of her friends, and she didn't come back.
Next thing you know, boom.
She brought her into a life of hell.
It was like shopping on Amazon.
You're just a product.
Well, the most popular internet site for escorts is called Backpage.com, where authorities say underage girls are sold for sex.
Backpage is the Walmart of human trafficking.
It's an incredibly profitable business.
We will never be the family we were before she was sold on that website.
We need someone to give us a fighting chance.
What if it was your daughter? How would you feel then?
This is a very important case.
Are these people wholesaling children in Washington State or not?
I'd like to meet the member of the judiciary or a member of Congress that thinks that the status quo is satisfactory.
I'd like to call the CEO of Backpage, Carl Ferrer.
I've never seen anything like that.
What are they hiding?
This hearing is adjourned.
There is a question as to what kind of society we're going to be, whether we're going to tolerate sexual trafficking in children. That is an affront to everything that we believe.
I want my daughter to hold her head high and know that none of this was her fault.
I am Jane Doe.
I am Jane Doe.
It's time for us all to stand up and be strong.
I am Jane Doe. So,
I Am Jane Doe, as you can see from the trailer, chronicles several children and their mothers who are Karen Silkwood, Erin Brockovich, all fighting truth to power. And they filed suit against Backpage, which was formerly owned by The Village Voice. And it is the largest online commercial destination for sex. And these young victims, these plaintiffs, were 13, 14, and 15 years old when they were exploited. I first heard about the story in the Boston Globe. I read about this lawyer named John Montgomery at Ropes and Gray that was representing Jane Doe's number 1, 2, and 3. I remember thinking, child sex trafficking? Like, what? Here in the United States? This can't possibly be. I had assumed it would, you know, far off places. And I was like, what exactly is child sex trafficking? And then I read that he lost the case. And I thought to myself, Backpage, the Village Voice, wait, it's legal in this country to host advertisements for the sale of children for sex? What is up with that? And that catalyzed this project, I Am Jane Doe. And the project originally started out to be sort of an examination of, you know, the challenging legal issues and are there internet free speech issues here? And I actually called and met with the general counsel for Backpage, Liz McDougall. And then I met the plaintiffs, and that was a game changer. This story became their story. This journey became their journey, seeking justice for an internet that has far exceeded our regulatory framework. And the thought that you can host ads for the sale of children, and as our own First Circuit Court of Appeals in Boston ruled, you can profit from, you can participate in, you can encourage child sex trafficking, no liability. I mean, what? This is the intent of Congress? So we started telling this story, and I Am Jane Doe opened last month. We opened in New York and LA and Washington, D.C., and several other key markets. Opened in Phoenix last night, and we're now doing special events. And what's fascinating is the ability of visual media to catalyze action. And it's kind of like it's in our DNA. And note to self, if you want to get something done in Washington, put a few senators in your movie and say, oh, by the way, what are you going to do about this problem? And what's amazing is this may well be, there's a perfect storm happening with awareness of this issue, with the idea that the wild, wild west online is okay. You know, we've just seen Facebook sort of melt down with fake news, right? We've seen terrorist bombing survivors sue the likes of Google, and why are you allowing terrorist communications on your site? Why aren't you monitoring? And that's exactly what our case is about. Technology has made companies more efficient and bigger and stronger. It is not a fledgling industry the way it was 20 years ago when there was regulatory protection for it. And why it's still the wild, wild west is what these children are asking courts to decide. And we have Rob Portman, we have Claire McCaskill, we have Heidi Heitkamp, we have John McCain. And I think that this movement on this issue may well be the only piece of bipartisan legislation that will happen with this Congress. The other fascinating piece about this film is the coverage the film has gotten. So, you know, critics are the bane of any filmmaker's existence, right? But when the critic for the Washington Post started comparing I Am Jane Doe to 50 Shades of Grey, oh yeah, we like that, right? Like, and the article was about the cultural, her story, right? And the cultural assumption about crimes in this country, particularly crimes against children of a sexual nature. You know, there's sort of this, oh, is it consensual? And, you know, we're talking about hundreds of thousands of children in this country that are victimized, a fact that I just had no clue about before I started making this film. And so, first of all, IamJaneDoeFilm.com. Please tell everybody you know about it. We're having special events around the country. We've come out of theaters. We were in theaters last month. We will be headed to Netflix, among others, in May, but our primary partner is Netflix. We're doing a follow-on piece that will be done in about a month and a half, and that's an animated short. And, you know, most of the children we spoke with had not a clue that they were being trafficked or had a pimp until 6 months in. And so we have, with the guys that won the Academy Award last year for Best Animated Short, with the writer from who wrote Toy Story, who's been my partner in crime through this whole journey, and with 10 survivors from Boston, young girls aged 14 to 21, we wrote an animated short with them, for them. And it's narrated by the great and fabulous Jessica Chastain, Academy Award nominee. And I think this is going to be such an unusual piece in the toolbox. It's not partisan. It's not political. It's about the four tactics the big bad wolf uses to lure Little Red off her path. So we are on a journey, my friends, and I just want to wrap it up by talking a little bit about you. In this room, you represent millions of dollars worth of purchasing power. My husband, yet again, I love him, he works for a reputational branding firm. 5 years ago, 60% of, and I'm sure you already know this, but 5 years ago, 60% of consumers bought products based on the quality, price, or value of that product. That paradigm has shifted. Now, 60% of all customers buy products based upon what a company stands for and what good this company is doing in the world. And that's where you come in. Many of you have marketing budgets that are focused on the product or maybe the service that you're selling. And advertising in the 30-second spot is a key piece, of course, of that strategy. However, with 60% of customers now evaluating their purchases based on who you are, what you do, and what you stand for, that's where we can help. Let's do this, baby. Thank you.